Greetings. If everyone can find a seat, we're going to get started. Well, that happened quickly. You guys are a good crowd. Hello. My name is Carmen Samuel. I'm the Associate Producer of Community Engagement here at NJPAC, and we partner with the Newark History Society to bring this to you at our venue three times a year. So we're excited to have another session. It's a great topic today. We look forward to our panelists. And before I introduce Tim, who doesn't really need an introduction with most of you, I would like to just point a couple of things out. We have some really cool free events that happen here at NJPAC. Sure, there's a ton of paid things, but I really want to make sure you guys know and tell your community members that there are things that we have here at the PAC that you don't have to pay a dime to come see, okay? One of those things is coming up this week, Beyond Gospel Music Series. That's going to be happening over at the Haynes Building. So it's Beyond Gospel, meaning this particular one is Expressions of Faith through Hip Hop and Spoken Word. If you're interested, we have a PSENG True Diversity Film Series that's coming up. The next one is actually Girl Rising. It's going to be here in NJPAC in the Victoria Theater. So all you have to do is RSVP for that. And then we also have a stage exchange, stage reading. So now if you look at this, I hope you guys will pick it up. I don't see any yellow out there, so I hope you guys will pick it up on your way out. All right. We have stage reading. So what happens is there are three playwrights from New Jersey and three New Jersey playhouses that partner, and we have a stage reading right here in this room. And then the very next season, those New Jersey playhouses actually put on a full production of the show. And you'll see here, this is March 2nd, but we actually had to cancel due to an actor illness, so it's still time to catch Derek Cloud's Turning, which is based on a gymnastics team that started right here in Newark. So if you guys are interested, they were over in Berlin, please come out March 16th. It says that the tickets are for $5, but they are not. They are actually free now, because what you're going to do is pick up my card, and you're going to email me and say, Carmen, I would like to come to the show for free. And I will say, absolutely, I'm going to put your name on the list. Okay? So without further ado, please welcome the president of this wonderful volunteer association called the Newark History Society, Mr. Tim Christ.
Thank you, Carmen. You can see why we like working with her. She's very organized and very enthusiastic. So let me add my welcome. And a thank you to John Schreiber and NJPAC for hosting us again tonight. I think this relationship is 3 or 4 years old now. And we're really pleased to be able to hold three events a year here. This is the start of our 16th year of the Newark History Society. I think Warren Grover and I can't quite believe that 16 years have gone by. We've put on more than 70 programs in that period, all free and open to the public. We have a great lineup this year. September 17th, back here in this room, we will have a program recalling Martin Luther King's visit to Newark 50 years ago, just a few days before he was assassinated. And Mark Krasovic of the Price Institute at Rutgers Newark is forming a panel, and he's calling it Martin Luther King, Newark, and the Quiet Spring of 1968. And then in November, this was John Schreiber's idea, on November 13th, as part of the James Moody Festival here at NJPAC, we're going to have a program on Sarah Vaughan. And Walt Chambers, an old family friend of the Vaughan family, came up with the title just last week. Walt, I think we're going to call it Sarah Sassy Vaughan, The Life and Legacy of Newark's Own. Eileen Hayes, whose recent biography of Sarah Vaughan, will be the prime speaker, but we'll have a panel consisting of Walt Chambers, Barbara Kukla, and John Schreiber. So keep that in mind for November 13th. If you're on our mailing list, you'll hear about all of these. If you aren't, please fill out one of these forms. I put one on about every third chair. Either hand it to me or to George Robb at the end of the program tonight, or mail it in. Even better, if you include $25 for your dues, we'll be even happier. So much is happening in Newark in history these days. I just learned today about a program that Tom Ankner can tell you more about, that on Saturday the 24th of March, there's going to be an all-day symposium at the Newark Public Library on the marking the 50th anniversary of the medical school fight, which was so intense in Newark 50 years ago. So, Tom, you'll have more information on that, and some good panels are being put together. But tonight, we're focusing on Lyda Clanton Broner and the Newark Museum. And we're pleased that Ulysses Dietz is here, the co-interim director. Is Deborah here too? Okay, so Ulysses is here, and others from the, Beth Ahrens from the Newark Museum, welcome. And we're delighted that our good friend, Mary Sue Sweeney Price, who was director of the Newark Museum for 20 years, from 1993 to 2003, will introduce our program by talking about the Newark Museum's remarkable history of collecting art from underrepresented groups. And then she will introduce Christa Clarke, who will tell us about Lyda Clanton Broner. Mary Sue?
This is a volunteer organization, which makes all that you've just talked about all the more impressive. So thank you, Tim and Warren Grover, and William Penniston and George Robb, and Carmen Samuel, and anybody who was responsible for inviting Christa and me to talk about a favorite subject, which is the pioneering collecting history of the Newark Museum. Thank you also to Ulysses Grant Dietz. Well, you've just heard, recently retired chief curator and current interim co-director, for your assistance in so many ways. Seeing so many colleagues and friends here today, you've all heard much, possibly too much, about John Cotton Dana, the famed librarian who founded the Newark Museum in 1909. But there are a few newcomers and young people here who may not have. And it's so important that those of you who are in the generation that is succeeding Ulysses and mine and Tim's and too many of us here, you are the stewards of this great museum and its encyclopedic collections, and therefore I really can't stress enough the importance of what you are now directly or indirectly really responsible for as citizens of Newark and people who care about Newark. And why should you care? Both Christa and I will be discussing objects, very concrete things, that have found their way into a very non-virtual institution. Collecting and related preservation has been described as a, and I quote, deeply moral act. Museums are sacred places because we place in them the objects that matter most to us as a culture and the objects that we believe mattered to other cultures. Newark's John Cotton Dana was both aspirational, and I quote, in his Charm magazine, he wrote, "Would exhibits of the life, the customs, the problems, and the ideas of a neighbor people lead us to better understanding of that people?" Remember, this was an immigrant town. It always has been. Dana further said, "Would it help break down hostility and open up paths to friendship?" We answer these questions in the affirmative. And he was pragmatic, writing that these newfound friendships would lead to happier and thus more productive Newark labor force. Dana's legacy is a hallmark of Newark's, of course, last major civic renaissance, which occurred just over 100 years ago, when the city's 20th century trajectory seemed to promise unlimited possibility and substantial wealth. Indeed, the institutions founded at that time, be they civic or religious, public or private, became bulwarks of a sort, I guess, that either blocked progress or, as in the case of the museum and other progressive, higher purpose sister institutions, such as the library, sustained our faith throughout the economic, racial, and class divides of 20th century Newark. Dana's many innovations, both as librarian and museum director, are obviously too numerous to delve into. So Tim has asked me to address this one lens, the legacy of collecting objects by underrepresented individuals or groups. And this impetus literally began as the museum was founded, with Dana's insistence, along with a small group of like-minded directors, that his fledgling institution would primarily collect works of American artists. How bizarre for us today to wrap our heads around the fact that this was a radical proposition. Art will only flourish where it is asked to flourish, he proclaimed, and in his famous letter that you've, I'm sure, heard about to Max Weber, said that while he may not have understood what that very gently abstract artist was doing, he was morally obligated to collect it. Dana's commitment to the underrepresented, ooh, where's page three? Dana's commitment to the underrepresented American abstract painter and sculptor, printmaker, and especially American folk artist has resulted in one of the finest collections of mid-18th to mid-20th century American art in any public collection. Hiram Power's Greek Slave, which is from the mid-19th century, may well be the most important 19th century American sculpture in existence. To say that no major exhibition of American art of these centuries and schools is complete without loans from our holdings is by no means an overstatement. Once again, a reason to be proud and to donate generously to the Newark Museum, to the Newark History Society, and NJPAC. The same can be said of his willingness, Dana's willingness, to both exhibit in 1911 and then acquire the nucleus of the Tibetan collection that under the successive stewardship of Eleanor Olson, Valerie Reynolds, and Catherine Paul is known as one of the finest and most diverse in any Western museum. Diverse as, unlike other holdings, ours not only represents the bejeweled statuary and elaborate tankas of the temple, but also the clothing, furniture, and other implements of daily life of those underrepresented individuals who actually entrusted their cultural heritage to a museum half a world away, fearing the annihilation not just of their religion, but of their folkways. Another long and romantic story that could be the subject of another symposium. It was, in fact, Dana's off-stated, just to go forward, clearly the fact that the Dalai Lama considers Newark a pilgrimage site is significant in that this tradition continues. It was, in fact, Dana's off-stated reverence for objects of daily life that provided the impetus for much of Newark's non-traditional collecting. As the world turns, today these collections are very often remarked upon as irreplaceable treasures, due in large part because they were ignored by almost every other museum, so they're unique in our holdings. Ulysses brought two examples to my attention. This Otto Preitschler wine glass was purchased from our 1912 Modern German Applied Arts exhibition with the core idea that a simple, not quite simple, but beautifully made, goblet was a work of art and could be displayed as such, something that Dana brought into the museum world. And this piece of Clifton pottery made in Newark was part of the landmark 1910 exhibit, Modern American Pottery. Ulysses notes that the idea that ceramics was art was still radical in museums in this period. We led the way here too. In an art, not to mention science, collection of over 80,000 objects, there are many tales to tell. So I'm going to just conclude with a few examples from my two decades as director. Beginning with its Tibetan holdings, Newark has been no stranger to objects of devotional culture, and especially to the small d of daily quotidian devotion. Such was the collection of Bengali folk art assembled by David Nalin, who was a World Health Organization consultant in East Pakistan, now Bangladesh, in the 60s. His gift of more than 1,000 objects, small bronzes used for daily veneration, rather than than large, imposing masterpieces was the impetus for a 1995-96 exhibit, Cooking for the Gods, the Art of Home Ritual in Bengal. Curator Reynolds and her consultant, Penn doctoral candidate Pika Ghosh, who had grown up in Calcutta surrounded by such objects, teamed up with New Jersey's large Bengali community, and in particular, a powerhouse woman, never to be forgotten, named Dietri Bagchi, who with her friends created this altar to Vishnu and his consort Lakshmi, replete with rice flower drawings, palm fans, and an ever-changing tableau of sweets on bell metal platters and bowls. We understood that this altar must be ritually tended throughout the run of the exhibit, and new protocols were established to accommodate the ministrations of Mrs. Bagchi and her circle, just as they would have done in their own homes. When the exhibit traveled to the Palmer Museum at Penn State, they replicated this entire idea. The Newark Museum's reputation, not as a temple in a park, to reference Dana's repudiation of the Euro model, but rather as Newark's living room, which was a phrase coined by my husband Clement Price, and a place for approachable learning and discussion, took the shape of another unusual project, artist Pepon Osorio's Badge of Honor, commissioned by us in 1995. First exhibited in a Newark storefront, organized by our partner in this project, La Casa de Don Pedro. Badge of Honor took the form of a son's bedroom on the right and his father's jail cell and the conversation between the two, literally and figuratively. From Newark's barrio to our galleries and subsequently shown at museums across the country and currently at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, Osorio's remarkable work, to quote the Los Angeles Times, is an authentic documentary made as a kind of community outreach exercise under the aegis of the Newark Museum, first shown in an old storefront in a working class district. Its audience were regular folks who just wandered in. Many reportedly were moved to tears, while the video drama between incarcerated father and at-home son rings with authenticity and timelessness. The environment Osorio has placed it in elevates it to a work of art that addresses universal questions. We could not afford and nor had the space to collect this work, but I'm showing it because I can think of no more underserved, misunderstood community than those of the incarcerated and their families. Certainly out in the wider community and most certainly within the walls of a major art museum. The Badge of Honor, by the way, was deemed by father and son to be their wife and mother who kept this family together. Dana's dictum that a museum must, and I quote, bend its energies to supply some of the material which that community needs, took many forms, among them the highly radical precedent-setting practice of enabling the community to see itself on the walls of the museum. His pioneering Homelands exhibitions, for example, encouraged school children to bring for exhibit precious family heirlooms that their parents had emigrated with. More contemporary theoreticians have noted that by sharing cultural authority with communities, today's museums avoid the audience-defeating trap of visitors not seeing what they like and who they are, after which it is said that they feel excluded from the museum and what it represents. Dana knew all of this a century ago. Again, the heritage that we should all be so proud of. A recent New Jersey Crafts Annual curated by Ulysses and E. Carmen Ramos featured, in addition to the expected crafts that we all love to go to fairs to see, works by traditional bead makers, African-American doll designers, a Ukrainian embroiderer, and a traditional Delaware Bay skiff maker. Here are two pieces of an African wedding ensemble by Newark tailor Amadou Diallo and a Panuelo for Viema by Alberto Morgan, all collected for that exhibit. 1997's triumphant crowning glory, images of the Virgin of the Arts of Portugal, commingled fine and folk art, much to the consternation of the more hidebound art historians who were our partners in Lisbon, and concluded with a video of Newark's own procession honoring Nossa Senhora de Fatima, prompting New York Times critic Holland Cotter to note, quote, such items would rarely have found a place in a show like this a few years ago. Bringing us closer to the next presentation, my last examples of non-traditional collecting reference Christa's two predecessors. In 1982, curator Ann Spencer mounted In Praise of Heroes Contemporary African Commemorative Cloth, quoting from Christa, 3 years in the making and a landmark in the field, the first of its kind. Previously overlooked by collectors, these cloths are powerful icons of contemporary social, cultural, and political events in African nations. Examples from Newark's collection, again, not collected by anyone else, so ours are prized, have been borrowed by such esteemed institutions as the Victoria and Albert in London. Although not from the original cache, this conga, a double wrapping cloth from Tanzania, is especially powerful for us today in Newark. In 2001, curator Nee Quarkapoom and several colleagues, including Eric Rucker, who is sitting right here, organized Faces of Worship, a Yoruba God in Two Worlds. Objects from our collection were placed on an elaborate recreation of an indigenous Nigerian Yoruba shrine to Shango, God of Thunder. Pendant altars dedicated to the deity by people of African descent in the diaspora from Brazil, and especially from right here in Newark, include the work by Eric Rucker, which was collected in toto by the museum. And I don't know if everybody knows who he is, but he's right there, the artist among us and priest. This strong foundation of collecting African art is a tradition that has been enlarged by Dr. Clarke, who serves as senior curator, Arts of Global Africa, at the Newark Museum. Since her appointment in 2002, which I am very proud of and was very honored to work so closely with her, she has organized numerous exhibitions ranging from men's fashion to Nigerian modernism, many traveling to other venues, and stewarded several hundred acquisitions, including textiles, photography, ceramics, video, and site-specific commissions. She has also placed the arts of Africa in global context. Christa recently completed a major masterful reinstallation of the Arts of Global Africa, relocated to our Brady Gallery in the first floor, which I encourage you to see if you have not yet, and edited the museum's first ever collections catalog, Arts of Global Africa, the Newark Museum Collection, with contributions from 45 noted scholars and culminating a multi-year initiative funded by the Mellon Foundation and the National Endowment for the Humanities. In addition, she has published extensively on a wide range of topics, representing Africa in American art museums, A Century of Collecting and Display, examines the impact of museum practice on the formation of meaning and public perception of African art. African Art in the Barnes Foundation received the James Porter and David Driscoll Book Award from the African American Art History Association and a first place for excellence from the Art Museum Curators, which is a tough group to impress. Christa has held fellowships at the Smithsonian, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Clarke Art Institute, and teaching appointments at NYU Abu Dhabi, Penn, George Washington, Rutgers, Purchase College, and Drew. She currently serves as president of the Board of Trustees of the Association of Art Museum Curators. She received a BA in Art History and English Literature from the University of Virginia and her MA and PhD in African Art History from the University of Maryland, where she studied under Ekpo Ayo and David Driscoll himself. She is a 2017-2018 fellow at the Hutchins Center at Harvard's Du Bois Institute, where she is working on the project about which she will now speak. Christa.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I have to do my acknowledgments now. So I'd like to first off thank Tim, Chris, and George Robb for this invitation, and to Carmen Samuel for hosting us here at NJPAC. I'd like to thank the Newark Museum, especially our co-interim director, Ulysses Dietz, who's enthusiastically supported this book in all ways. So I also acknowledge the support I'm receiving from the Du Bois Institute at Harvard and the community of fellows that have been giving me wonderful feedback. And acknowledge all of you. I hope you are the experts more so than me in Newark history, so I really look forward to your feedback. And I'm especially grateful to Tom, David, and Albert Clanton, the grandsons of Lyda Clanton Broner and their families, for the privilege of telling her story. And Tom and Al, is Al here too? Al's here too. Tom and Al are here with their families, so yeah, thank you. And lastly, apologies in advance for my mangling of Zulu and especially Xhosa pronunciation, despite extensive and patient training from my colleagues. If you want to hear it pronounced correctly, you can go see Black Panther. So, after 28 years of desire and determination, I have visited Africa, the land of my forefathers. So concludes the diary of Lyda Clanton Broner, a middle-aged African-American woman from Newark, New Jersey, writing in 1939. Broner had just returned from an extraordinary 9-month-long journey to South Africa and back, funded with savings from a lifetime of work as a house cleaner and hairstylist. She is pictured here in a photographic portrait taken in a Newark studio shortly after her return, barefoot and posed in profile, wearing some of the things that she acquired during her travels. Dressed in a traditional style Xhosa outfit with Zulu beaded adornments on her head and ankles, Broner looks contemplatively at the beaded Xhosa pipe she holds in her hands as if recalling her journey. The much anticipated trip was motivated by not only Broner's sense of ancestral heritage, but also her grassroots resolve to connect the political and social concerns of African Americans with those of Black South Africans under the segregationist policies at the time. Her activism had emerged through her involvement in the African American Women's Club movement, her work in the Black beauty industry, and especially through her association with the nascent Council on African Affairs, an important anti-colonialist organization led by Paul Robeson and W.E.B. Du Bois. During her travels, Broner circulated among South Africa's Black intellectual elite, including many leaders of its freedom struggle. Her lectures at Black schools on race consciousness and race pride had a decidedly political bent, even as she was presented as, quote, an American beauty specialist. As part of her mission, Broner purposely assembled a collection of more than 150 works, pieces of beadwork, textiles, pottery, and basketry, many of which were gifts. After her return to the United States, Broner exhibited the collection as part of her continued activism, presenting the works in public displays at libraries and community centers to draw attention to the, quote, conditions of the Negro in South Africa. In 1943, Lyda Broner's collection was exhibited at the Newark Museum, and she later donated some 60 works in 1947. The works have, for the most part, languished in storage ever since. When I joined the Newark Museum in 2002 and began to familiarize myself with its extensive collection of more than 5,000 works of African art, I came across the Broner collection. Our online database offered little information beyond the fact that the donor was an African-American woman from Newark who had acquired the works while traveling in South Africa in the late 1930s. Though sparse, this information was tantalizing. Who was this woman? What were her experiences like as a Black woman traveling in segregated South Africa? What did these objects mean to her? How and why did the museum, Newark Museum, present the collection to the public in 1943? A window was opened onto the story in March of 2014 when one of Broner's grandsons, Thomas Clanton, contacted me out of the blue, wondering if the museum still had his grandmother's collection. Indeed, we did. And I eagerly invited Tom and his brother David, who are local. Al has traveled to join us from Virginia today, to the museum to look at the works. They came with an unexpected gift, the entire archive of their grandmother's journey to South Africa. This included an additional 90 objects, along with her extensive diary, her photo albums with handwritten notations, two scrapbooks, and other mementos. This extraordinary collection of objects, photographs, and text is the subject of a forthcoming book. Drawing upon this deep visual and documentary record, I aim to tell not only the story of Broner's remarkable journey, but to also consider what the collection says about her experiences there and how it was used in the context of her social activism upon return home. By privileging the agency of a middle-class Black woman, it provides a compelling and perhaps unique counter-narrative to the mainstream history of collecting African art, a history that centers on figural sculpture and white male elites, and generally excludes both women and non-canonical objects. However, this richly detailed personal narrative is more broadly relevant, speaking to larger themes including the role of African-American and African women in progressive movements, the New Africa movement in South Africa and the politics of identity, Black internationalism and Pan-Africanist ideology, and the role of museums in representing African visual culture. As an art historian and curator with a longstanding interest in the history and politics of collecting and displaying African art in the United States, my focus is one of many possible points of entry into this rich archive. I have come to describe my project as an object-led cultural biography. Over the past three decades, a rich body of scholarship has emerged that demonstrates how tracing the life history of an object or collections of objects through exchange, through creation, exchange, ownership, and use provides a valuable framework to understand its shifting meanings, associations, and relationships. My project is informed by this approach, considering first the assemblage of Broner's collection in the context of her journey to South Africa, and then the social and political circumstances surrounding the making of the objects themselves and the exchange. I then follow this transnational movement of the collection to the United States and consider its presentation there in relation to the identity of the collector and her mission. And finally, I examine its absorption, classification, and eventual decontextualization by the museum. While this research is very much still a work in progress, my presentation today focuses largely on this final chapter, considering the display and afterlife of this collection at the Newark Museum. Lyda Clanton Broner was 43 years old and the divorced mother of a grown son when she embarked on a journey by sea to South Africa in May of 1938. Born in Raleigh, North Carolina, Broner describes herself as the granddaughter of enslaved Africans brought to the United States in 1866, just months after abolition. She moved as a child to Newark, earned her high school diploma in 1912, and worked for decades first as a housekeeper and then a hairstylist, graduating in 1936 from Apex Beauty School in Newark. At the time, this was the largest Black-owned business in New Jersey and had an overseas presence in Johannesburg. Although she had yet to travel abroad herself, in the 1930s, Broner founded the Women's International Affairs Club in Newark, whose purpose was to educate Americans about the living conditions in other countries and to promote interracial understanding. She also hosted a young South African girl, Rilda Marta, who was educated at local Newark schools and eventually returned to her homeland in 1936. Broner's interest led her to contact Max Juergen, an African-American activist who went to South Africa as a missionary for the YMCA in 1922 and became politicized through his experiences there. Returning to New York in 1936, Juergen became the first director of the International Committee on African Affairs, which was later known as the Council on African Affairs, founded in 1937. Broner joined the council first as a member and eventually was invited onto their executive board in 1942. Through her developing relationship with Juergen, Broner also met Davidson Don Tengu Jabavu, a South African educator and politician who was elected the first president of the All Africa Convention, which strove to unite all non-European opposition to South Africa's segregationist policies. Jabavu became a close friend of Broner's while visiting the States in 1937, which launched the International Committee on African Affairs, and helped with her trip to South Africa the following year, providing entree to the black intelligentsia. This is my homemade map. I'm getting better at digital technology. Traveling by ocean liner from New York via England, Broner arrived in Cape Town on June 19, 1938. She journeyed through South Africa until the beginning of January the following year. Her trips included stays in East London, Alice, King Williamstown, Bloemfontein, Vereeniging, Johannesburg, Durban, and back, traveling primarily by train. And some of these trips were 21 hours long. And in fact, the train systems don't seem to exist anymore, so this network, which is amazing. She visited churches, community organizations, rural villages, townships, and educational institutions throughout the country, often speaking about, quote, the conditions of the Negro in the U.S. and learning about the issues facing black South Africans. Many of the schools she visited were run by missionaries, including the Wilberforce Institute, founded in Eventon in 1908 by the AME Church in the U.S., to educate ministers and teachers for leadership positions within their communities. As Broner notes in her caption here, it was the only black school run by African Americans in South Africa. In addition to these, she spoke at the University of Fort Hare in Alice, which educated blacks from across sub-Saharan Africa, many of whom later became leaders in independence movements and newly independent governments. And she spoke at nearby Lovedale, as well as Witwatersrand University in Johannesburg. In the Eastern Cape Province, Broner also visited Fort Cox Agricultural College in Healdtown, speaking during Nelson Mandela's final semester there. And it's one of my research trails is to determine that Nelson Mandela heard her speak. That would be great. I'm coming close. Throughout her stay, Broner circulated among and shared ideas with prominent black leaders and educators of different ethnicities, including Zulu, Xhosa, and Basutu. These local hosts and hostesses, many of whom had spent time in and or studied in the United States, facilitated her visits and speaking engagements. For example, while in the Durban area in September 1938, Broner's lodging and schedule of activities were arranged by Sibu Sisiwe Makanya, a pioneering educator and social worker who had also studied rural education and social work in the United States in the 1920s. Thanks to Makanya's efforts, Broner's two-week stay was a whirlwind of activity. She spoke to children at a primary school in Imbumbulu, visited homes in a kraal or local village, and went to Adams College, one of the oldest black colleges in South Africa. She also visited Oglange High School, the first black-directed educational institution in South Africa, and significantly, the place where Nelson Mandela would choose to cast his vote in 1994 in the country's first all-race elections. Broner's visit there was hosted by the wife of the school's founder, John Dubay, an important figure in South African social and political history, and the first president of what became the African National Congress. In Durban, Broner also spoke at the Taylor Street School, which she described as, quote, the first and one of three native schools the government helped build. Among the teachers there at the time of her visit were Govan Mbeki and Epinette Mbeki, the parents of the future South African president, Thabo Mbeki. Broner documented her experiences in South Africa through photo albums, scrapbooks, and a diary that offer a near daily record of her travels. The pages of her photo albums are filled with her own snaps, as she called it, images of friends and acquaintances she met along the way, candid shots of school children, and photos that she describes as women in native dress. They also included photos given as souvenirs by friends and commercially produced postcards purchased en route. The visual documentation of black experience, urban and rural, working in middle class in these photographs offers a powerful corrective to the ethnographic image of the African native that dominated publications from this era, as exemplified in the very postcards and other images that Broner also collected. In contrast to these, Broner's photographs, own photographs, document social relations and showcase historical realities obscured by tourist imagery and mainstream narratives, which typically represent Africans as exotic others. Broner's scrapbooks include media coverage of her receptions in South Africa, as well as typewritten notes, schedules, and speeches. In both formal receptions and at informal gatherings, her message appears to have been consistent: cooperation and unity. An article on Broner's November 4th, 1938 reception at Lovedale Missionary Institute in the Eastern Cape near Alice records her speech as follows, quote, "In America, though they had the vote, yet they could not use it freely in all the states. Though they had free education, there was still slavery of the 1938 style. The real secret of their achievement was unity. Africans no doubt had their difficulties, and they would overcome many of these by unity. Tribalism should go. Africans should think, act, and remain black," she said. To this end, Broner implored her audience to retain their traditions, such as their beadwork, warning that, quote, "When people wanted to subdue others, they took away their culture." Broner was told the next day that if a woman was found wearing a string of beads, she was put out of church, an illustration of the current tensions in South Africa between the, quote, "modern Christian African" and those who advocated pride in native traditions. Broner acquired examples of South African material culture throughout her journey purposefully, though without any overarching organizational representational framework. More than souvenirs, these objects were, to Broner, symbols of cultural expression that she saw as vitally important to black emancipation. Most of the works were presented were personal gifts to Broner from the people she met along the way, and represent genres largely excluded from the developing canon of African art, not the masks and figural sculptures admired and collected by the Euro-American avant-garde in the early 20th century. Many are modest examples of beadwork, such as the anklets and necklaces shown here. In addition, Broner's collection also includes pottery, basketry masks, and basketry mats and containers, and examples of Western-style handiwork introduced in Christian missionary schools. And from what I understand from my colleagues in South Africa, these mission collections do not exist there because they were not thought worthy of collection, so it's really quite unique. This is my favorite. She also collected objects that represented black life, including mud bricks used to build houses, and also samples of what she described as native staples, which she preserved in containers and brought home. She later boasted about how she grew South African corn in her Newark backyard. It is important to emphasize also the gendered dimension to this collection. Nearly all the works were created by women and represent genres characterized as craft, bearing little resemblance to the assemblage of spears and shields more typically collected by men. Together as a collection assembled by an individual through gifts, they embody a diverse web of personal interactions reflecting the breadth of Broner's experiences in South Africa. These relationships were documented by Broner in her diary and photo albums, and also on the tags that she attached to many of the objects, where she carefully recorded where she acquired the work, who gave it to her, and its maker. Here, for example, is a traditional beadwork necklace given to her at Imbumbulu from the pioneering educator and social worker Sibusisiwe Makanya, and a crocheted hat by Miss Dorcas Magato at the Helping Hand Club, a hostel for young professional women just outside of Johannesburg. Again, the emphasis on gift-giving and personal networks is a distinct contrast to the dominant, mostly male, and depersonalized practices of collecting that highlight ownership. Though modest in nature, the works in this collection speak to a particular era of momentous social and political change in South Africa, and they may be situated against this broader background of emerging African nationalism. If the collection was regarded by Broner as generally representative of contemporary Black South African life, a closer examination reveals inherent cultural tensions embodied by the objects, both collectively and individually. The range of works in her collection suggests the dual strands of thought at the time regarding Black South African identity. Art historian Lise van Robreck describes how ambivalence toward tradition and modernity characterized African politics of the day, in which regular debates were conducted about the values of African customs, cultures, and languages. Broner's collection encompassing traditional forms of beadwork and pottery, as well as art form taught in mission schools, is emblematic of the opposing emphases on tradition, meaning on the one hand, pride and heritage, and on the other, modernity, the new African in the form of the educated Christian. Many of the objects embody political and cultural debates and struggles within this very specific moment in South Africa. So let's look at two examples. A set of Zulu beaded anklets, for example, bears a tag that reads, "Gift of Dr. Mafavuke, Durban, Natal, September 27th, 1938. Broner provides little additional information about this exchange in her diary, only briefly describing meeting a, quote, native herb doctor during a visit to Durban with John Dubay and his wife. But historian Karen Flint's recent work on indigenous medicinal practices in South Africa complicates this narrative. She writes about Mafuvuke Nkobo, a licensed Isi Nganga, or traditional Zulu herbalist, who is surely the donor of this work. Nkobo was a wealthy man who owned 5 muti, or medicine shops, and operated a successful mail order medicine business in Durban in the 1930s. When white medical authorities challenged Nkobo's adoption of the Western title of doctor, he banded together with other Zulu vendors to form the Natal Native Medical Association in support of native medicinal rights. The Xhosa dress that Broner wears in her studio portrait is another example. She commissioned an izikaka, or traditional woman's skirt, Xhosa women's skirt, from Nongendu Mahambi during her stay with the Jabavus in Alice in November 1938. Originally made of leather, by the early 20th century, such skirts were made from white cotton blankets dyed with ochre and decorated with imported black braiding and beads. In Broner's descriptions, it is simply a native dress. But at the time, the traditional style Xhosa skirt had taken on a more complex meaning in the area through its adoption by members of the African Women's Self-Improvement Association. Founded by Florence Jabavu, David Jabavu's wife, the society was run by educated black elites who taught rural women practical domestic skills. According to historian Catherine Higgs, all women in the association were encouraged to wear a standardized traditional style Xhosa dress in order to downplay class and ethnic differences. The dress symbolized a universal Xhosa identity, which is actually an ethnic label that encompasses several different groups, and by extension, a united sense of purpose in the name of progress. Brought back to the United States in 1939 and exhibited throughout the 1940s, the collection becomes layered with yet another history as it crosses the Atlantic, that of Pan-Africanist ideology in the emerging civil rights movement in the United States. Lida Broner returned to New Jersey on February 13, 1939, entering her written travelogue with the signature Lida Nolwande Broner. She had been given this Zulu name, meaning mother of the oceans, by her South African friends. In an interview given to a local newspaper around the same time, she offers her perspectives gained through firsthand experience. "All in all," Broner observed, "as a result of my trip, I have concluded that the Negro problem in South Africa is a very grave one. However, the solution of the problems lies in the education of the American Negro on the conditions under which the natives of South Africa live," end quote, by which she meant education informing a unified struggle against oppression. What Broner collected became essential to her goals as a social activist who regarded the struggles of Black Americans as fundamentally connected to colonized Africans. Actually, to colonize people around the world, regardless, Indians included. Following her return, she became increasingly active in the Council on African Affairs, which had emerged as the leading voice of anti-colonialism and Pan-Africanism in the United States until the mid-1950s. Bruner's collection played a central role in her activism, its display accompanying lectures that she presented throughout the 1940s. Max Juergen, the Council's executive director, expressed great interest in Bruner's collection shortly after her return and strongly supported her proposal to exhibit the works, noting the, quote, great value that such displays could have in familiarizing audiences with present conditions in South Africa. Bruner's displays, initially presented under the auspices of the affiliated Women's International Affairs Club, became formalized as part of the agenda of the Council on African Affairs beginning in January 1942 when she joined their executive board. With the United States having just entered World War II, the Council was focusing its efforts on, quote, the needs and possibilities of the people of Africa in world conflict, end quote. Bruner's appointment to the board coincided with and perhaps even motivated the Council's goal of what they described as enlarged types of educational work. By May, the Council had adopted a plan for community meetings. According to the board minutes, quote, the meetings should consist of a lecture on Africa and its importance in the whole war effort and should be accompanied by an exhibit of African work and culture. The community meetings were launched in the summer of 1942 at Bruner's home at 109 Highland Avenue in Newark, just a block from Branch Brook Park. There, she hosted a reception for the Council on African Affairs and displayed her South African collection. And I should note that the photo here is undated and the location is unknown, but probably similar to what some of these domestic displays looked like. As part of her planning, Bruner reached out to Beatrice Windsor, who served a dual role of both the director as both the Newark Public Library and the Newark Museum. And she requested a dedicated space for books on, quote, Native African people at the library. Windsor responded enthusiastically, offering a prominent place on the first floor, and also followed up separately in her role as Newark Museum director with a request to see the collection. Your material sounds very interesting, and the museum should know about it. By the spring of the following year, plans were already in place for the Newark Museum to exhibit Bruner's collection as an accompaniment to a May 25th lecture at the museum by Max Juergen on the topic of Africa and New World Relations. The 1943 exhibition of South African works collected by Lida Bruner at the Newark Museum and its subsequent donation in 1947 is, to my mind, a unique chapter in the history of representation of African art in the U.S. in U.S. museums. I elaborate on this further on. First, I'd like to provide some context in order to understand the ways in which Bruner's exhibition offers an important counter-narrative within this broader history of collecting and museum representation, and also how it fits squarely within the mission of the Newark Museum. Time tonight does not permit a lengthy discussion of history of African art collecting in the United States, but to summarize, objects from Africa first entered American museum collections in the late 1800s, first as ethnological specimens or curiosities in natural history museums. And in the early decades of the 20th century, art museums began to acquire objects from Africa, often as a component of primitive art, a category that also included art by indigenous peoples of the Americas and the island cultures of the Pacific. Initially, such museum collections were wide-ranging and eclectic, their importance justified in terms of their civic and educational value rather than, or in addition to, their artistic merits. By the 1920s, fueled by interest on the part of modernist artists, there was an increasing emphasis on the aesthetics of African art, and with it, a narrowing vision of what was considered worthy of museum display. The quintessentially Western conceptual foundations of the art museum reinforced hierarchies of value based on media or genre, favoring paintings and sculpture appreciated solely for artistic qualities. These aesthetic biases resulted in the privileging of figural sculpture and masks from a very narrowly defined region of West and Central Africa, excluding large categories of visual art such as beadwork, textiles, basketry, and other works of diverse media throughout the continent. and founded a durable canon in museums, if not a stereotype. And this is exemplified here by the 1935 MoMA exhibition, African Negro Art, which its long legacy is still felt in many museum displays of African art. Authenticity, defined as a work made for and used within a context considered culturally traditional, became an important criteria for selecting objects. Representational practices in both natural history and art museums presented such works as anonymous creations of a timeless and disappearing way of life. And of course, these histories of collecting and display were largely shaped by white, mostly male protagonists, based on unequal power relations, and reflect the biases and racializing tendencies of the era. There's our friend. The Newark Museum offered a different paradigm than most American art museums, one whose mission and programming, I will argue, made possible the exhibition of Bruner's collection in 1943. And you're all familiar with the museum's origins, and Mary Sue has already elaborated on this distinguished history, so I will simply state that Newark fostered cultural and visual literacy through the study of common objects of daily use, both locally made but also from foreign lands. Founding director John Cotandina believed that everyday objects could serve an important role in increasing public understanding of world cultures. And an early and innovative example of this mission may be seen in 1916 when the museum mounted the first in a series of exhibitions entitled Homelands, which Mary Sue mentioned as well, presented as a companion to the exhibition Textile Industries of New Jersey, which exhibited commercial, industrial, artistic, and historical textiles from the region. The Homelands exhibition was devoted to textile traditions from different ethnic groups in Newark. In developing the exhibition, the museum reached out to children of foreign parentage via public schools and asked them to contribute textiles made in their home countries. In the end, examples of textiles from 19 different European nationalities representing Newark's populations were put on view. The Homelands exhibition fostered appreciation of foreign craft for the edification of both recent immigrant groups and Americans not of foreign parentage. It is important to note, especially with regard to the later exhibition of the Bruner collection, that the model adopted by the Newark Museum in these Homelands exhibitions had antecedents in the United States, not in the art museum, but in settlement houses, institutions dedicated to social reform that served immigrants. The Newark Museum began to acquire objects from Africa in 1917, the year after the first Homelands exhibition. Believing that works created and used by people in far-flung lands especially held appeal for their potential to educate the public about ways of living very different from the urban environment of Newark. These collections were developed by visitors to the continent, mostly businessmen and missionaries, but also included Dana, the museum's director, who made three trips to North Africa in 1924, 1928, and 1929. Newark's collecting and exhibition program was distinctive in its embrace of a wide range of object types, particularly those of daily use, and a whole continent approach that expanded beyond the confines of West and Central Africa. And while objects from Africa were officially categorized as ethnology, the museum early on emphasized their appeal as applied arts, offering useful examples of everyday designs. As significantly, the museum presented such works as examples of living traditions of artistic production, in contrast to the ahistorical approach adopted by most museums, which presented this kind of timeless Africa. One such exhibition was Modern Cairo and a Few Egyptian Antiquities in 1929, which highlighted recent purchases made by Dana on a collecting trip. They were presented in mise-en-scène displays, such as a Bedouin home featuring a fully erected tent, seen here, a Cairo bazaar, and live demonstrations of textile weaving presented alongside rugs. Seeking to connect the works on display to an audience that might find them culturally meaningful, the museum also publicized the exhibition in New York's Arabic language newspapers, of which there were five at the time, with a total circulation of over 20,000, a community engagement strategy well ahead of its time. As the nation moved into the war years, the museum's desire to showcase different ways of living in far-off countries shifted emphasis. In December 1942, a year into World War II, the museum debuted a series of exhibitions entitled Native Peoples in the Theaters of War. These were intended to give audiences a sense of life in remote parts of the world involved in the war through displays of their material culture, amplified by public programming and suggested reading. Showcasing non-Western objects from the museum's permanent collection, the exhibitions took place over the course of a year, focusing on North Africa, Alaska, Australia, the Pacific Islands, China, and India. As described by the museum, quote, "Our primary purpose has been to present peacetime ways of Native peoples in the battle areas." The exhibition attempted to provide some historical context for the works on display, noting in the label copy whether certain objects like weapons were still used in the present day, and provided daily updates with news from the regions at the beginning of each section, which is, to me, an amazing thought. Further, it is clear from both exhibition documentation as well as internal files that the museum had an understanding that the plight of people living in these various parts of the world was due as much to global politics and colonialism as it was due to war. For example, the Docent's Guide for the India Gallery ended with a discussion of decolonization activities and a celebratory profile of Gandhi and his revolutionary efforts. The Newark Museum was actually, surprisingly, not alone in presenting global war-related programming in the 1940s. Indeed, this was a larger trend that can be seen across American art museums. In the New York vicinity alone, the Museum of Modern Art mounted Bali, Background for War, in 1943, featuring Native sculpture, paintings, and idols, quote, collected by anthropologists George Bateson and Margaret Mead. The exhibition was aimed at preparing Americans going to Bali during wartime to better understand the peoples and customs. And the Brooklyn Museum presented exhibitions on European nations and their colonies, including Netherlands and the Netherlands Indies at peace and at war in 1943, as well as others such as the 1945 exhibition, War Weapons of the Pacific, Primitive Weapons and Modern Warfare, which compared Army and Navy weaponry to those used by Pacific Islanders. What distinguishes the Newark Museum among these broader efforts is the geographic breadth of its exhibitions, which included Africa, and their progressive bent. To a much greater extent than other museums at the time, the Newark Museum framed their programming to make more explicit the connection between the works on the display and global politics, including references to the plight of colonized people and nascent struggles for independence. So it is in this context that the Newark Museum displayed Lida Broner's collection in 1943. Although South Africa was not considered part of the theaters of war, the exhibition may be seen as conceptually linked to the museum's broader mission and programming on global politics, offered to an interested public as examples of, quote, Native arts and crafts representative of contemporary Black South African life. Museum displays of African objects were still relatively infrequent by the early 1940s. To showcase the collection of an African-American woman within the contemporary socio-political context of colonialism was, I suspect, unprecedented. The collection is also distinctive for the era. Broner had personal connections to nearly all of the owners or creators of the works in her collection. Indeed, most were acquired as gifts, rather than by force or coercion that typically characterized the unequal power dynamics of early collecting. As mentioned above, it did not conform to the developing canon of West African masks and figural sculptures made by male artists. Instead, its focus was on South African beadwork, textiles, basketry, and pottery, created primarily by female artists. And it was not collected under the rubric of modernist primitivism, a racialized ideology that extolled selective works of non-Western art as masterpieces while simultaneously framing them as essentially ahistorical, untouched by Western civilization, and lacking in artistic intent. Instead, Broner's collection embraced a wide range of objects that she herself carefully documented as being made in the 1930s, often with the names of their makers. Her collection also included works produced in mission schools, which typically would have been rejected as inauthentic examples of cultural expression. The Newark Museum presented Broner's collection in May 1943, along with a lecture by Max Jurgen on Africa and New World Relations. Unfortunately, no visual documentation of the month-long exhibition exists. But museum correspondence describes Broner as wearing her Xhosa dress and playing recordings of South African music at the exhibition's opening. The exhibition attracted media interest and was well received. Broner was interviewed by the Newark News the day following Max Jurgen's lecture and asked to return to the newspaper offices a few days later to be photographed in her costume, as shown here in the published article. In it, she observes, quote, "I was particularly impressed by the likeness of the American and the African Negro. Only here we have free and compulsory education, whereas they must pay for their education and that limits them. They have the same desires and ambitions as others, and there are strong and able leaders among them," end quote. It is significant that the article here focuses as much as anything on the social and economic conditions for blacks in South Africa, a sure measure of success on Broner's part in promoting the work of the Council for African Affairs through the display of her collection. In the years immediately following the Newark exhibition, Broner continued to exhibit her collection at libraries and community centers under the auspices of the Council on African Affairs as a means to draw attention to the conditions of black South Africans. In 1947, Broner decided to donate her collection to the Newark Museum. On one level, it is remarkable that a major museum would want to acquire such an unusual set of objects, yet the process of its accessioning by the museum reveals the fundamental frictions between private collecting and the acquisition policies and procedures of museums. Broner's collection was received by departing director Beatrice Windsor, who expressed gratitude for the, quote, "very interesting and valuable collection of South African material," end quote. However, Windsor's successor, Alice Kendall, after reviewing the collection, wrote to Broner that there are, quote, "a few pieces which are, in a sense, duplicates of other items in the collection, and a few pieces that do not seem strictly of museum quality," end quote. In this moment, the richly layered experiences and subjective values embodied by the collection are overridden by normative museum categories and standards of qualities. Works defined as redundant and of lesser quality were returned to Broner, and those that were accepted by the museum were duly classified in, according to conventional museum standards and stored according to the type of object. Tags with handwritten notes documenting the circumstances of their collection were removed, detaching the works from any kind of historic or cultural context, and replaced with accession numbers. Museum registrars noted Broner's notes documenting the specific circumstances of collecting, including names and dates, on the back side of index cards, as you see here. But the front was reserved for the standard criteria for cataloging objects. Object, country, size, and description. This is the information that was eventually recorded in the museum's database when its catalog cards were transcribed and computerized beginning in the 1990s. For much of the past 70 years, the collection has laid in storage, surfacing only piecemeal and the occasional theme-driven exhibition. They have become museal or museum-like, a concept introduced by German philosopher Theodor Adorno to describe objects that no longer carry meaning for the visitor and as such are in the process of dying. Museum objects, he writes, stripped of the personal narratives that their previous owners ascribed them, occupy a twilight world ordered by the rules of institutionalized knowledge, end quote. If museums are storehouses of knowledge or temples to aesthetics, what is lost in the process of absorption and classification is the intellectual environment of the collection, the conditions surrounding their original acquisition and use by the collector. The Broner collection remained in this twilight world well into the 21st century, and it was not until 4 years ago, when I was first contacted by the Broner's grandsons, that the donor's biography and the rich history of this collection was revealed. The objects rejected by Alice Kendall in the late 1940s and retained by the family could now be reunited with the museum's holdings along with the Broner archive. How do we situate such collections in museum spaces? How can these objects, photographs, and their stories be remobilized to shape our knowledge and understanding of South African visual culture, and more broadly, African visual culture? The associations and meanings embodied by Broner's objects tend to be overlooked or perhaps even undermined by standard art historical approaches and associated museum practices that sort them according to abstract typologies. But seemingly unremarkable objects can collectively possess relevance. A cultural biography of Broner's collection shifts our perspective from a Euro-American privileging of masterpieces and great collectors to reveal the power of humble objects to animate the respective experiences and aspirations of South Africans and African Americans during a time of struggle and oppression. Lyda Clanton Broner's story has certainly encouraged me to explore its potential to enrich and complicate familiar narratives of African art and collecting. While a small recent exhibition offered a glimpse of this story, a future project is to reassemble and display the entire collection, along with the supporting documentary material, animating the lost history behind these objects, and moving beyond formal appreciation into much more rewarding historical and cultural territory. Such an exhibition would have the added virtue of connecting the museum to the community of Newark, honoring the museum's tradition and the memory of a remarkable and intrepid woman. Thank you. Can I take questions? Yeah. I'd be happy to take a few questions or comments. Yes.
Oh, hi. Thank you. In reviewing the journals, was there much text in the journals or memories recorded about life in South Africa?
Yes. Yeah. Her diary is entirely about her travels to South Africa. And so, you know, it's a nearly daily record of what she was doing, you know, ranging from the mundane, like I washed my underwear, repaired my shoes, but also a lot of commentary. I was telling Tom earlier tonight, I've read it, I don't know, 25 times now. I keep sorting it out in different ways, and so there's a lot of commentary on the economic conditions for blacks in South Africa, racial relations, lots of examples of, you know, kind of aggressions and passive and a resistance that she makes against South African whites who try to, you know, make her move off benches and things. A lot of recordings of, you know, she did people's hair and sold beauty products her whole time. So there was a lot of great information. And she had fun. She was out dancing a lot till 2 a.m. And she had apparently at least 3 marriage proposals. It's pretty good. She was like 47, so that's pretty good.
Yes. Thank you for your scholarship. I think this is an amazing life. I mean, for her to document not her genealogy coming in 1866, that in itself is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I was wondering, what's her education? What year did she die? And, you know, what was her inspiration to really want to, you know, of all the countries on the continent that she could have went, why South Africa?
Those are all good questions. She graduated from high school in 1912, and she didn't have further education. She went to Apex Beauty School. Tom, she died in 1982. She chose, I mean, South Africa is a really interesting choice. I mean, she starts her diary, you know, talking about the land of my homeland, which of course, you know, from a genealogical standpoint, no enslaved Africans came from South Africa. But there's this sense of connection, and I think there were these strong currents between black South Africans and African Americans in the 20s and 30s, lots of going back and forth. And so I also think, you know, just because of the Middle Passage and the trauma there, that, you know, until these recent DNA you know, discoveries where people can actually say, I'm from Ghana or I'm from Nigeria. You know, Africa existed as a big place. And so South Africa was a homeland. And I think, you know, so the way was paved through all these connections. And then she had the South African girl that was staying with her. Apex Beauty School, which she graduated from, had an office in Johannesburg. So, and the Council for African Affairs, which she had gotten involved with, you know, had a South African. So South Africa and the United States has this really kind of interesting, you know, internationalism happening in the 20s and 30s. So, yeah.
Okay. Hi. Hi. Again, thank you for your scholarship, as well as thank the, hi, everybody. Thank the family as well, and the woman, Bronner, herself, for doing this and bringing this information to us. You said that there may be a future, well, there will be a future exhibit. I wanted to know, will there be a reading, or will the museum consider a reading of the actual journal so we could hear her voice and her story in her words?
I think that's a great idea.
And I just want to also offer something, Story Corps. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you know anything about it, but I'm sure they would love that type of information as well. Thanks, Tom, Al, thank you.
You're welcome. Yes, your question. Yes, she's bringing the microphone. Sorry, Carmen.
Thank you. Does she talk in her journals about why or how she acquired what she acquired and how she decided what to acquire or purchase or?
No, not really. I mean, she expresses interest. I mean, she definitely looks at things as, you know, there's the native work, which by which she means beadwork and kind of pottery and things like that in the mission school. But she doesn't really, I think they're just kind of representative of a moment. I think when you start looking at the objects themselves, that's what's interesting, why I'm trying to take this approach, because they really embody these kind of different threads happening in South Africa, although she's not seeing them. The differences at that moment. She's looking at them as broadly representative of her experience. She's definitely trying to collect the whole time. You know, it's clear that that's part of her mission, and she often gets these things as gifts after she's given lectures. When she visits schools, she purchases a few things, the skirt, the outfit she had made. But there's no sense in, like, I want to collect, you know, this beadwork. She's kind of looking to what people are willing to give to her.
Where is she buried?
Tom, where is she buried?
And I've got one other question. Glendale, oh, in Bloomfield, there, right, right. And the address of her house on Ridge Street, you said?
She was 109 Highland. And then she moved to North 3rd Street.
Okay, where did she spend the more formative, her more formative years in Newark? Is the house still there?
The house is still there, but unfortunately, it doesn't look the way it looked when we moved in 1950. When we moved in, it was an Irish-Italian neighborhood in 1950. My grandmother did this exploration in 1939. I wasn't born to 1950.
Yes. My grandmother did this exploration in 1939. I wasn't born to 1950. But my brother Al back there, who was born in 1940, I believe, I'm giving away his age, he could probably give you a little more, 1941. But we lived in Newark from 1950 up until her death, 1982. We moved out in the early 70s, but Grandma was not leaving her house.
I think there should be a plaque on the house.
You know, I went by the other day just to take a look, and I believe it's owned by the city now, and it looks like it's ready for demolition, and it really did hurt to see it. Yeah, it really did hurt to see it. But it was a great place for us back at that time. Again, you know, we lived there from 1950 up until the early 70s, and Grandma stayed until 82 until she passed away. Yes. You know, Christa, I would really just like to thank you for bringing Grandma's story to light.
You're welcome.
We could have never done this without you. And as I say, we have adopted her.
They have. I get lots of texts to their sister.
Christa Clarke, yeah. Clanton now. That's her new name.
Yes.
And I just, you know, again, we, yeah. when this project came up, we knew that it was in good hands, and we just gave the ball to Christa, and we just said, run with it. You know, whatever you think is the right thing to do, you do it. And she's just done an excellent job. And
thank you for trusting me. Thank you. Okay, just maybe two more, Tim? Two more.
Thank you. I'm very impressed with this woman and all of the documentation that you've discovered about her. I know the grandson personally, but my question is like two parts. Does the diary or your research show how many times she actually made the trip to South Africa? And the second is, notice that it says she had to save for a total of like 28 years to make the journey. And another little part of the newspaper said that she had to work a month for $5. So is there any indication of how much this journey cost her?
Good question. Well, the first question is she did not return to South Africa. She did travel to West Africa in 1963, and there's less information known about that particular trip. There's not a diary that I know, but maybe these guys will uncover that at some point. Did you want to say something about that? She was very concerned with kind of the economic conditions of Black South Africans, and she does record in her diary a lot of things about how much they were paid. And this was 1938 and 39. This is before apartheid, but at that time it basically was apartheid. It just hadn't been voted in. It was a lot of laws were already enacted where people could go to school, where they could restricting their movements. And so she was kind of documenting all of that, and especially, you know, the what people are paid, how long they have to work, the inequities of society in South Africa. I'm very interested in that, and making the observation that she came home and felt that African Americans were in a better place, despite, as she put it, slavery of 1938 style in the US, but that they were still in a better place, and convinced that that these Blacks in America had to connect their struggles to the larger, you know, global struggles, which was this very powerful moment of Pan-Africanism that I don't, you know, hasn't, right before the war, and especially with the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935 and a whole host of events that happened, you know, really highlighted the oppression of colonial people around the world. And then with the advent of World War II, it also highlighted the weaknesses of colonial governments. And so it was this amazing moment of Black internationalism that I'm not sure there's ever been, you know, I mean, I'm just learning myself, I'm an art historian, but it seems like there's never been such a strong moment where people were agitating all around the world and with linked, you know, struggles. And she was part of that, so it's pretty exciting.
Okay. Yes, hi. I just wanted to know, did she draw a lot of parallels between her treatment in South Africa and in the United States in her journals? I know you mentioned about the benches and people telling her to stand up and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think, I don't know if she, you know, parallel, I mean, she certainly documented it. And when I have this, like, as I said, a kind of topical breakdown of the diary, and I have, you know, kind of like the injustice section, because it was just pretty long, as you can imagine. And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, she's on the ship and it begins already. People, the whole diary documents from the moment she leaves the U.S. to when she returns. So it's really just the ship and her stays in London. But all along the way, you know, everybody on the ship assumes that she's the seamstress. She's told, does she want to dine at you know, a separate time? And she's, you know, and basically they're saying, we don't want you seen in the ship's dining room. The white people don't want to see you dining there. And she's like, no, I'm fine. I just, you know, I can eat with everyone else. And so she's resisting the whole time, you know. And so she has, like, story after story of, you know, things that happen to her. But she's also using, her limited agency as an African-American in South Africa. Because at one point she's asked to get off this bench, which was for whites only in South Africa. And the policeman says, you know, you need to leave. And she says, well, you know, I am not a citizen of your country, and your laws don't apply to me. And he's like, well, where are you from? And, you know, she says, I'm from the United States, and so he lets her stay. You know, so, you know, not all her stories were so successful, but, you know, it's so, there's not, I mean, I'm sure, you know, there's not a lot in, because the diary doesn't really cover what's happening in the U.S., there's not a lot, but I'm sure, you know, she felt it was palpable every step of the way. In London, the same, you know, she had a reservation when she showed up and they saw she was black, the reservation was gone. So, you know, this, it happened all along the way.
So, one more, he actually got
this. Thank you. Just to give you a little insight on Mrs. Bronner, what it was like being raised by her. She was very active in politics in Newark. She was very active with the Board of Education, and she always stressed, you know, education, homework. She was very dynamic in saving. She used to save her money in jars, and she had one jar of pennies, one of nickels, dimes, quarters, and the dollars. And I don't know about my brothers and sister, but that's how we used to get movie money on Saturdays. And she used to take me with her on the weekend when she did domestic work up in South Orange, New Jersey, for a lot of wealthy families up there. And she was stressed to me. She said, son, she said, this is why I want you to go to school, you and your brothers and sister, because I've been gone for 12 hours and I made $6 for the day plus car fare. But she had a knack of coming home with shopping bags full of clothes for us and frozen food that the people that she worked for were about to throw away. And just to give you an idea of what kind of maverick she was, the people that she worked for, her children, wore Lord and Taylor jackets and suits. And when I was in middle school at Robert Treat here in Newark, one day one of the teachers put her hand on my jacket, and she noticed, I guess, that it was a silk material. She rubbed. She says, "Ooh," she said, "where did you get this jacket?" She said, "This is silk." I said, "Oh," I said, "my grandmother buys my clothes." So she said, she opened the label and Lord and Taylor. And that evening, before school was over, everybody in school knew that there was a little Negro boy, or color, black, whatever you wanted to call us, that had a Lord and Taylor suit on. And the next day, when I told my grandmother, she went to school the next day, and it wasn't nice, okay? She was very fiery, okay? And, you know, she was always telling us to defend yourself, treat people the way you want to be treated, and say your prayers. She was a great woman, great experience for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming. We hope to see you on April 16th for our program about the Germans of Newark. But one more round of applause, not just for Christa, but for the Clanton family, for Lida Clanton-Broner, and what a gift for Newark.